Good evening, and welcome to the Frist Center for the Visual Arts. My name is Megan Robertson, and I'm the Associate Curator of Interpretation here at the Frist Center. Thank you for joining us for our opening lecture for Irving Penn, Beyond Beauty. The exhibition is on view in our upper level galleries, and I hope that you will visit after this evening's lecture. We're open until 9 p.m. We are very pleased to have Merry Foresta, the organizing curator of this exhibition, with us this evening to tell us more about Irving Penn's photography. Merry Foresta was the founding director of the Smithsonian Photography Initiative, which she served from 2000 to 2010. Previously, she had served in the Department of 20th Century Art at the Smithsonian American Art Museum. She was named the museum's first curator of photography in 1982 and was subsequently appointed senior curator of photography in 1992. During her tenure at the Smithsonian, Foresta built one of the world's premier collections of American photography. She has curated exhibitions and authored catalogs on a broad range of art and photography subjects, including Perpetual Motif, The Art of Man Ray, Photography of Invention, Pictures of the 1980s, and Secrets of the Dark Chamber, The Art of the American Daguerreotype, among many, many others. Currently, Foresta works as an independent curator and advisor for the arts at various museums, archives, and libraries. Recent projects include Artists Unframed, Snapshots from the Smithsonian's Archives of American Art, which was published by Princeton Architectural Press in 2015, and the exhibition Irving Penn Beyond Beauty, which is on view here at the center. Yale University published the catalog of the same name, which incidentally is available for sale in our gift shop. The Frist Center would like to thank the generous sponsors who supported this exhibition, which you can see listed here. Irving Penn Beyond Beauty was organized by the Smithsonian American Art Museum. We'd also like to thank the Metro Nashville Arts Commission, the Tennessee Arts Commission, and the National Endowment for the Arts for their ongoing support of our exhibitions and programs. And finally, we would like to thank you, Merry, for presenting a talk here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming her to the stage.
Thank you all so much for coming out tonight on this beautiful, can I call it spring? It's still February evening. It's great to see you all here, and it's certainly nice to be here talking about Irving Penn. Before I started, I want to really thank the Frist family and staff here at the museum for just such a warm welcome to Nashville. I've never been here before, and I may come back. It's just a really great city. I very much want to thank Megan, who has been amazing in terms of all of her organization, in terms of putting all of this together. I certainly want to thank Mark Scala for the beautiful installation he's done of this exhibition here at the Frist. When you put an exhibition together and you organize it for your home museum, and it's such a delight to take it on tour and see what another museum does with the works. It's like seeing a brand new exhibit again, and that's always wonderful. And my great thanks to the director, Susan Edwards of the Frist. She has a wonderful organization here, and I really thank her for putting on Penn to such in such great style. Irving Penn was a very courtly man. He was very proper. He was very reserved, you might say. He was a man of very few words. He certainly was authoritative. When a model wasn't standing in the right position, he certainly, when he told her to step left, she stepped left very quickly. Hold your chin up, and she did. A portrait subject, whether it was a fairly unknown ballet dancer or whether it was Truman Capote, responded to Penn's stare when he was posing him in front of him. But he did have one phrase that he used very sparingly, but when he did, you really took it to heart. And when he thought something was quite good, he would say very crisply and very thoughtfully, "That is very fine." And I think if he saw this exhibition here, he would say, "This is very fine." So here's me. So I wanted to start tonight by framing what I'm going to be showing you with a bit of an introduction that has to do with inspiration and creativity And in a way, to be frank, how does an Irving Penn get to be an Irving Penn? What inspires a young man to start making pictures the way Irving Penn did in his early 20s? What sustains a career of over 70 years, working both as a commercial photography for the pages of magazines like Vogue and Harper's Bazaar, Look and Life and other European magazines? What sustains the private projects that he did, the personal projects he did throughout his career? What drives all of that? And one answer we might have is given to us by Irving Penn himself. In 2004, 5 years before his death, he produced a book which was called A Notebook at Random. And A Notebook at Random is about as close to an autobiography as Penn would ever give us. In this, he kind of collected lots of samples of things he had done throughout his career. Early pictures, test strips from some of his platinum palladium experiments, magazine pictures, drawings that he had made, and this fabulous drawing, which is called The Artist Tree of Influence. Now, what you might notice is that the roots of this tree is made up of the names of a variety of painters and sculptors. We have Leger and Morandi and Kurt Schwitters. We have Braque, who I find very interestingly is a much bigger type than Picasso. We have Beckmann, Malevich. We have this great surrealist, folk artist Archimbalgo, we have Van Gogh. We also have, if you look closely, we have the great fashion designer Balanchine at the bottom. Balenciaga figures up towards the top. That's the root system for this artist tree of influence. On the top, the fruit of this tree is given over to photographers. At J, Margaret Cameron, the great 19th century portrait photographer, Olga Sander, whose portraits of the German working class were so important to a generation of modernist photographers. We have Russians, we have Rodchenko, we have the British, Bill Brandt, and the Americans. We have Weston, we have Walker Evans in there, Strand. Stieglitz gets a little name in there. And interestingly enough, sticking up at the top, we have John Sarkowski. We even have a curator of photography up there in this. So what we have is something that is actually quite radical. We have the artist tree of influence, which is a mix. The roots of it is in art history of the painters and sculptors of modernism that meant so much to Penn. And we have his named influences of these grand history of photography figures at the top. And he was not shy about telling us where he came from and how he got there. There's another thing that I'd like to do this evening and frame this talk into the history of the moment that Penn represents. He's a grand photographer, certainly a master of his work. But his life story and the story that his art tells us is also a story that is shared by the history of photography itself. The history of photography as an art form that gains increasingly importance throughout the 20th century and even now into the 21st century, when so much of contemporary art is made out of the medium of photography, when the history of photography shares itself with so many other kinds of media, and in fact itself is become such a broad, inclusive look at the medium of photography itself. What you see here is an installation photograph for one of the first big modern photography exhibitions done in the United States. In 1938, Beaumont Newhall, newly anointed as the chief librarian of the Museum of Modern Art, soon to become its director of photography, does an exhibition called Photography 1837 to 1938. It was, in fact, the 100th anniversary of photography. And in over 800 images, Beaumont Newhall defines what photography is. And I show you this one in particular because you won't recognize any of the people who are in Penn's history. his tree of influence. But in fact, what you have is this broad history of photography, which includes X-rays of fish skeletons, scientific evidence over here. We have X-rays of common objects, including shoes and light bulbs and fans. And we have photographs of the corona, astronomical photographs of corona of the moon. In other words, photography in Beaumont Newhall's presentation of it encompassed a very broad swath of image making. And this is the year, 1938, that Penn graduates from art school. This is the kind of world that he comes into, one that is open, it's experimental, and it is embracing a wide idea about what an image can be. So this time we're going to start at the beginning and go to the end. This is the very first photograph I've ever found that Penn published. It was made for the annual of his school, and it's just a simple photograph, very clear, very crisp, made up of shadows and solids. And Penn is very clearly taken with the idea that photography can give us a version of life which is made up of shadows and solids. How did he learn to do any of that? Well, he had the great good fortune of having as one of his teachers a man named Alexei Brodovich. Brodovich is one of those extraordinary 20th century characters who did a little bit of everything. Born in Russia, he quickly moved to Paris, where he was an important member of the Paris avant-garde, the cafe scene of the 1920s. He was a graphic designer, he was an architect, he was a painter, he was a photographer. This is from a poster competition. These are all posters designed by Brodovich that were put on a big wall on Rue Montparnasse in 1924 to advertise the big surrealist Bal Banal, was what it was called. Brodovich won first prize, and he got to have his posters all over Paris. Picasso won second prize. Brodovich was brought to the United States by the editor of Vogue magazine in 1934. And as an extra job, he took on teaching advertising design at the Pennsylvania School of Industrial Arts, which is where Penn was a student. Penn must have been a very important student for Brodovich because they quickly became friends, and Penn began spending summers as an intern with Brodovich at Harper's Bazaar in New York, and was able to work with Brodovich as he began to redesign Harper's Bazaar. This may look tame to us today. It's fairly radical. Brodovich really stripped the pages of all the fussiness, and he did very avant-garde things like this, curving the type to match the photograph, in this case, of the evening gown. Brodovich took Man Ray to exhibitions like the great 1937-38 exhibition of Fantastic Art, Dada, and Surrealism that was at the Museum of Modern Art, which included many of the surrealists that he had known in Paris, including people like Max Ernst and André Bresson. And at the top is, of course, Man Ray's great painting of floating lips over the observatory in Paris. One of the great things that Brodovich did with these artists was to add them to the pages of the magazine. And so he began including artworks in fashion shoots and sort of bringing together this world of art and world of commerce on the pages of Harper's Bazaar. People like Salvador Dali designed covers for the magazine. And certainly Penn was there to witness the transformation of the magazine, meet many of these artists, sit in the background while lively conversations about the state of the world, the state of art, and the ability of culture to survive what was happening in Europe as these artists were fleeing the beginnings of the Second World War, arriving as immigrants into New York, and often finding their way to their friend Alexei Brodovich's office. none of that education was lost on Irving Penn. He'd worked for Brodovich as an intern. When he graduated, he became Brodovich's assistant. Not bad for a first job. He designed little drawings that Brodovich was nice enough to put in the magazine and pay him for. So what does Penn do? Penn, who's never taken a class in photography, so he takes the money from his first paycheck and he goes out and buys a Rolleiflex camera. And he begins walking around the streets of Paris, he wishes. He begins walking around the streets of Philadelphia and New York and taking street scenes, what he called camera notes, as he strolled around the streets. He was learning to photograph. He was learning what the flat frame of the framing of the camera could do, the flat picture frame of the photograph, and he was certainly, his eye was certainly tuned to a surrealist moment of floating eyes in an optical shop. Was he influenced by Walker Evans? You might have thought so if you'd looked at this kind of work by Walker Evans. The capture of American vernacular signage, American vernacular architecture, the straight-on look of Walker Evans' frank take on American culture at this point. But now let's remember, Man Ray has been infused with Alexei Brodovich, this Russian immigré, and all of these European artists who have come in. And the darling of the European artists, the photographer darling, was not Walker Evans, but Eugene Atje. Atje was that incredible photographer who roamed the streets of Paris at the turn of the 20th century and collected a vanishing world in Paris, collecting that found surrealism that appealed to so many of the European artists. This was the kind of work that really appealed to Penn. So much so that as he began to walk and as he began to train his eye, he began to be more radical with the camera. He pointed it up, he pointed it down. And that idea about reality and shadow that he had started with comes to a much more sophisticated take when he produces images like this. It is a wonderful exercise in what happens when you turn the camera down and flatten your picture plane and make more of a short perspective. But it's really something more. It's really an image about communication. It's an image that is a self-portrait because, of course, we see Penn has put himself in here. But he's giving us other messages as well. These were cutout signs that were hanging. It was a shop that obviously made keys and sold guns. And so we have the shadow cast of the key and the gun. But it's not just any ordinary key. What do keys do? They open up ideas for you. That key is, this is the key, he says to me. I'm a shooter now. That's what cameras do. They shoot. I'm a shooter now. And the person in control of this shooting is me, the artist, and there he is. So, what do you do if you're the assistant to Alexei Brodovich, art director at Harper's Bazaar? You're 23 years old, you've got a camera, and you're already making pictures. What do you think you do? Well, what Penn did was quit. He quit, and he said, I'm going to Mexico City, and I'm going to paint. I'm going to become a painter. Why would he do such a thing? Going to Mexico City was a little bit easier to answer. He went to Mexico City because all those artists that were passing through Brodovich's office were themselves on their way to Mexico City at that time. Mexico City had long been this cafe society, international city, and it was about to host its own version of the Museum of Modern Art Surrealist show. The great international exhibition of Surrealism was about to open in Mexico, and so all of these artists were going to go down there and spend some time in Mexico. So Penn seemed to think, why not follow them down there? The painting part is a little bit harder to understand. This is a man who had never taken a painting course, as far as we know, didn't even dabble in it, but he decided to be a painter because at that moment, being a painter was as close to announcing that I'm going to be an artist as he could possibly have gotten. He wanted to be an artist. He wanted to make art that people would think of as art. So he got on a train in New York, went to New Orleans, got on a boat, and went to Mexico City. And he spent almost a little over a year there. And he painted. But at the end of that year, he decided he wasn't really going to be a painter. He wasn't a very good painter. So he scraped all of the paint off of the canvases. He rolled up the canvases, tucked them under his arm, and came back to New York. So he didn't bring back any paintings, but what he did bring back were suitcases full of photographs. It turns out that when he got on the train in New York and headed south, he had two cameras with him, that wonderful little Rolleiflex, just a little handheld camera, and he also had a 4x5 camera that he sat on a tripod. And every time the train stopped on its way through the south, he would get off and set up his camera and photograph the buildings and people that he discovered along the way. Now, I'm guessing that the train didn't stop for very long, and he didn't go very far away from the train, but what he did discover were many young African-Americans who were busy working in shops or shipping areas around the train, and he began photographing them. And he says that he stood at a respectful distance from them and photographed them as he found them. But I would put it to you that the stance of these young men is about as stylish as you could possibly find. The young man who stands slouching, looking over his shoulder, could be a fabulous model. But Penn found these poses and I think put them away, began to create an index for himself of the way people stood, the way clothes hung on people. And you begin through these images to see Penn assembling himself for what would come next. He did get all the way to Mexico, and things get a little dark when he gets to Mexico. He's definitely thinking in surrealist terms here when he goes to flea markets and finds curious things like chicks in a jar, which he brings back to his painting studio and photographs in this anonymous floating space, a specter of nature being contorted by this glass jar. He does come back, as I said, and guess what? His luck continues because this young man comes back, having quit one job, he immediately gets hired for another. This time, he gets hired by that other person who's on the trunk of his tree of influence, Alexander Lieberman, who is now art director of Vogue magazine. And guess what? Penn goes to work for him. This is the kind of redesign of Vogue magazine that Alexander Lieberman was as involved in as Alexei Brodovich was involved in the redesign of Harper's magazine. It's probably important to note that in the late 1930s and through the 40s, one of the great places to encounter art in the United States was in these fashion magazines. You would see the latest work that it was being shown at the major museums. You would see contemporary art matched with contemporary fiction by the most important writers. You would see reviews of current ballet. You would see reviews of theater. And in this case, you would see a model at the Museum of Modern Art, photographed by Edwin Blumenthal in this case, standing behind Marcel Duchamp's large glass, which was on view there. So again, this mashup of high art and low art is constantly going on in the magazines, and you were a lucky person if you had a subscription to both of those magazines. You not only knew what to wear, but you knew where to go and what to think. It is wartime, and Penn does leave for Europe as a volunteer with the American Field Service. And in this capacity, he drove ambulances and throughout Italy and Czechoslovakia and Poland, and he also was a photographer. He photographed many of the soldiers at rest, near camps, but he was close to the front lines. And after the battle, he waded in to many of the places that had been overtaken. And he began to do these wonderful series of the after effects of war. And he was especially taken with this idea of posters and images on walls, images within images on these damaged wall. There's a very amazing article that Vogue publishes in 1945 by Irving Penn. It has no photographs in it whatsoever. It's an essay by Irving Penn. And its title is something like, Why We Fight. And in this piece, he basically says, why we fight is the preservation of culture. He says, why we fight is the preservation of culture because it is culture and art that makes us human. Up on the front lines, what he was aware of is how close civilization had come to a kind of destruction. And I think it was something very profound for him to think that through the making of art, and certainly through the collection of the world through images of photographs, it could be preserved. But he does come home to New York again, and he does go back to work for Vogue and Alexander Lieberman. Lieberman and Penn were very close throughout their working relationship. They seemed to have an extraordinary collaborative partnership. Alexander Lieberman, as I say, was very much about expanding the world through this magazine. And I think in Penn, he really found the photographer who could express what he was talking about. Penn really started out as a still life photographer. Many of his first images were still lifes for the magazine. And images like this become a very sophisticated rendering of the still life form, still very surreal, still very much a reference to maybe Dutch 18th century painting. Penn loved the history of art, as we have seen, and certainly the reference here would have been very specific. This is an image that was made for an article published in Vogue in 1947 called Elements of a Party. This presumably is in your New York apartment how you would have thrown a party in 1947, or would have been encouraged to do so. It's far more than that, however. Penn has basically given us a wonderful index of some of the culture that had survived in Europe, what he had collected in his mind about the preservation of culture through art, because it's not just any things that are here. We have beautiful damask linens from Ireland. We have a Limoges China white cup. We have a beautiful blown glass, aperitif glass. We have a Dutch Delft coffee pot over there. We have a Parma hand and a beautiful cheese. And we have a beautiful bag of golden grain sitting on this table. We have something else there as well. We have the thing that Alexander Lieberman advised Penn to always put in his pictures, a drop of poison. Always put a drop of poison in this picture. And in this case, the drop of poison is that little black bug that's on the golden bag of grain. Penn suggesting to us that as luxurious as this is, and as wonderful as we may want to use these things for our party here in New York, be careful. There's always a lurking bug about to get your bag of grain, and don't take it for granted that your culture is safe. Penn was known for experimenting with all kinds of things, and his work as a still life photographer certainly splashed over to his ability as a portrait photographer. This is a portrait of all the producers on Broadway in 1947. And it must have been a feat of amazing diplomacy to get these people to sit next to each other and to cram some of them on these rough pillows in the front, and he squinched some of them up to the top. It's hard to think that they were contained at the top of this. We're talking about directors, and here's Penn, the major director, who's getting these people in here. These were the kinds of images that had not been seen in Vogue before, and so were quite eye-catching to anybody who would see them. But Penn has added, I love putting this one in here because it is a lovely touch of poison in this. Can anybody see it? Right up at the top. Let's see if I can make this work. It's a human skull. It's certainly a reference to poor Yorick, who would have enjoyed being part of a theater group. But it's also a sense of the passing of youth and vitality. It is a memento mori touch that Penn often uses. As I say, Penn was becoming quite the important photographer of Vogue magazine at this time. At the time, Vogue was published 20 times a year, every 2 weeks or so, and Penn was in every issue and sometimes multiple times. And he was given a task to produce a series of celebrity portraits. And these very famously have become known as the corner portraits. Now, in the past, a portrait would have been made by carrying your camera to somebody's living room and having them pose with their favorite book or their favorite dog or whatever. But in this case, Penn said, it's happening in my studio. He stripped everything away, and he took two theater flats, and he put them together as a corner. And he had every single person pose in this corner, or he had them drape themselves over a pile of old rugs. I mean, these are pretty important cultural figures, and he said, sit on this old pile of rugs in this ugly corner and pose for me. What it did was strip everybody away. Penn was actually going after the idea that you could photograph personality. If it was stripped away, you could see it. And I think you can see that he's captured the famous surrealist Salvador Dali, whose ego is so big he actually had to expand the corner for Salvador Dali. But we might also look at his corner portrait of the very famous, at the time, designer Charles James. Charles James was known for designing a dress with one bolt of cloth by wrapping it rapidly around the model until he had designed the dress and put the bow on it. And here, he's seemingly done that, and in a collapse of exhaustion has fallen to the floor. And of course, we have the young Truman Capote, whose anguish is evident in this corner portrait. If you notice, the portrait changes, the corner changes size depending on how Penn would like to influence these people. But a question was asked to me yesterday or today, how much did Penn design these and how much did the person, the sitter, pose for Penn? And I suspect in the case of people like Truman Capote, it was a little bit of both. Capote was a bit of a drama queen, and I think he certainly took advantage of this wonderful corner. But over time, these would be published every time Vogue came out. Over time, and this is what the page would have looked like in Vogue, Penn began to assemble with these portraits almost a catalog of mid-century icons of culture and activity, both high and low. And on this spread, we have an Irving Penn photograph up at the top, the two eyes. We have Pavel Tetlachev, an artist. We have John Updike. We have Charles and Emily Adams. Charles Adams, the cartoonist of The New Yorker, are the couple sitting over here. And we have the Ducek brothers, the stars of a new idea, wrestling on television. And these are the Ducek brothers. So on one spread, you're given high and low, writers and painters. And this kind of idea was certainly a very exhilarating one for a mid-century moment. Penn was sent on wonderful fashion shoots. This one was called Flying Down to Rio, and He couldn't really find his subject. This was the model Jean Pache. And according to Jean Pache, they walked and walked and walked and walked and walked and walked, and Penn kept saying, no, not here, no, not here, I don't know what to do, until one day Jean Pache sat down and took her shoes off and said, my feet are killing me, I can't go on. And he said, that's it. We'll have a tourist walking around Lima, and that will be the fashion essay that we'll do. And so here's Jean Pache with her shoes off. The portrait is obviously about the shoes, and we have a wonderful look at these shoes available at Bonwit Tellers for $14.95, should you be interested. But Penn did something very special here, which seemed to mark the rest of his career. After the shoot was finished, the Vogue staff went home, and Penn took the train to Cusco, went up into the mountains. And there he discovered a photo studio. And he paid off the photographer who owned that studio, and he said, why don't you take a vacation for a week? I'd like to use your studio. And so when the wonderful little Chechquia Indians came down for the Christmas holiday festival, and came to have their portraits made, as they always did every year, they didn't find the photographer who was usually there. They found Irving Penn, who photographed them for about a week during the Christmas holidays of 1948. Penn was quite taken with this studio. You can see the backdrop that he has here. You can see that he is posing them in a just a lovely natural light. He's posed them in front of the painted backdrop that the photography studio had. And we have beautiful portraits that are as much about fashion and pose and the imposition of Penn the artist's eye on this portrait as it was about just describing this native culture. Penn returns to New York and in 1950 is sent to Paris to photograph the first couture shows that followed World War II. And he did so by acquiring a north-lit photographer's atelier and sending out some of the Vogue people to find him a canvas backdrop. Clearly, he still is thinking about that Cusco photographer studio. They bring back the canvas, and that becomes the backdrop that Penn uses to photograph the couture of 1950. This is the recently married Mrs. Penn. This is Lisa Fossengrave's Penn. They had been married in New York just before the trip. And Lisa Fossengrave's Penn was something of a muse for Penn. She's very beautiful. But she was an established fashion model when they met. And she certainly informed Penn about what it took to be a great fashion photographer, how to pose, how to catch the light, how much face to have in a picture, how the bones would look at any time, the line of body and fabric. This is a Rocas mermaid dress introduced at that moment. And what we see here is indeed Irving Penn creating Lisa Fossengrave's as a mermaid. She doesn't seem to have any feet in this picture. How she's standing, I'm not quite sure, with the grace and skill of a great model, I suppose. But it is a beautiful picture, and it is rendered with that smumato smokiness of that canvas behind. Penn would keep this canvas. He would roll it up and bring it back to New York, and he would use this throughout his photo shoots for the next 30 or 40 years. This is also from that same Paris shoot. At the time, you went to Paris in August, and he spent 2 weeks in Paris photographing fashion and also photographing a series that had been suggested to him by Alexander Lieber, men of small tradesmen that were around the streets of Paris at the time. And you see that he's using the same backdrop as he had used before. This is a cucumber seller. And this is Giacometti, and he also did a series of portraits. It must have been quite a couple of weeks. In this little tiny stairway, there were models in Balenciaga gowns coming down and cucumber sellers going up, passing Giacometti as he was coming up for his sitting. It was intense, it was incredible, it was exciting, and certainly produced an amazing series of images. Penn, of course, continued his fashion career in New York for Vogue. This is one of his extraordinary images from a black and white issue that Vogue produced in 1950, somewhat later in that same year. So you can see he's very interested in the way that silhouette can function as much as that smoky, soft focus could function in order to describe fashion. This piece describes the shape of that hat and the shape of that sleeve. And so he's describing fashion and the effect of fashion as much as he is the details of fashion. But something incredible began to happen in Vogue. They had a changing of the guard. And Diana Vreeland came from Harper's Bazaar to start running Vogue. And she brought with her favorite photographer. It wasn't Irving Penn at the time, but it was Richard Avedon. And this is a Richard Avedon from the same period. You can see a very different photographer. And I think they were friends, but they certainly were great competitors. They were the Ali and Fraser of Vogue magazine at the time, and certainly fought for fashion assignments, and it was something that Penn had never had to do before. It was also true that the economy was tightening up, and the idea of going to Paris and spending 2 weeks photographing fashion was getting a little rough. And so Penn kind of left the fashion world for a while and became something of a great portraitist at this point. This is a much later Truman Capote, framing his own face for Penn. A kind of dialogue is taking place. But Penn also solved his problems of feeling neglected at Vogue by taking himself to far away places to photograph. This is the tent that he designed. It was a canvas tent. Penn was not about to give up his studio if he was going to Africa, so he simply designed one and took it with him. And this, you can sort of see Penn is here, standing here, posing his subjects, and these were all the people that would gather around while he was making his pictures. It was a lively scene, and it produced images like this, however. Again, we have Penn's studio being a dominant player in this. This is not about creating a document. This is about Penn creating a great portrait, and in some ways a great fashion piece. We might question today the idea of this white man going to post-colonial Africa and photographing the natives. But I think Penn's idea at the time, if we can give him this, is that he was very adamant that he was creating a global idea about beauty. That beauty, fashion, culture was not held fast by a Western culture, but certainly could be informed by non-Western cultures. Increasingly, private projects began to dominate Penn's life. And in so doing, he pretty much insulted everyone. Because in the late 1960s, he took up the idea of platinum printing. Platinum palladium printing is a very complicated, time-consuming, exhaustive chemical process that happens in the darkroom. It takes many proofs to make it work. It needs to be registered. It's exhausting work. And Penn was captivated by it, and this was the first series that he made specifically to be created in a platinum process. What does he do to take the most expensive metals in the world? He goes out and picks up cigarette butts, and he brings them back to his studio, and he photographs them as if they were beautiful Limoges china. He lights them. beautifully. He prints them in platinum palladium. Not only that, but he prints them on Arches watercolor paper, which is quite large. I hope some of you have seen them in the show already. And not only that, but he then shows them in one of the most important art galleries in New York, the Marlborough Gallery, that only showed paintings and sculptures. So when I say he insulted everyone, the magazine world said, "What the heck are you doing? You're making beautiful photographs out of cigarette butts? Is that a slap in the face to what fashion is, what portraiture is?" And the art world said, "Wait a minute, you can't make photographs. You're a commercial photographer. And what the heck are you making these really big photographs for? And we don't understand what you're doing." Well, there's nothing like a radical shock to create a certain amount of enthusiasm for images, because these were much talked about and much celebrated, so much so that the Museum of Modern Art did an exhibition of these in the mid-1970s, only to be followed by an exhibition of this material at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. There was a great deal of critical response to these, and I think that this really launched Penn into another strata of picture making, and certainly collapsed the world officially between the pages of Vogue and the ability of art to embrace photography as a contemporary art. And with that, Penn did something quite extraordinary, which is he pulled several boxes from under his bed. I speak metaphorically, I don't know where he kept them. But in the late 1940s, when he was photographing beautiful fashion models and celebrity figures in his stripped-down studio in the corner of his room, he began a series of nudes. In the late 1940s, after hours, he would invite artist models to come and pose for him in his studio. And this is obviously a nude in a corner, one of the first nudes that he did. But he made other images that were, in his mind, academic nude studies. His models, his experience would have included Edward Weston and Bill Brandt and other nude sketches by people like Picasso in his thinking. He did something else to them. When he printed the images, he made them, this is not an exaggeration, very mottled. He bleached the pictures. He took out color. He retoned things. The original vintage prints of these look like a bunch of crinkled rice paper by the time he got done. He distressed the whole process of photography in order to do this. When he later printed them as platinum palladiums, they come across more like sculptures by Brancusi. Interestingly enough, or perhaps not surprisingly, some of his supporters really did not encourage him. In the late 1940s, Alexander Lieberman said, "We're not going to put these in the magazine. We can't put magazines. Don't have nudes like this." Edward Steichen at the Museum of Modern Art, then the curator, said, "Penn, you got to cut it out. This isn't going to take your career anywhere if you start doing stuff like this." Penn had an exhibition in 1960 at the Alexander Iolas Gallery, extraordinary in itself that a photographer was having in 1960 an exhibition at a gallery that was known for painting and sculpture. But there was a lot of correspondence between Iolas and Penn about what Iolas referred to as the pubic problem. So Penn put them in a box, put them under his metaphorical bed, and left them there until he began to succeed, began to produce photographs that would be considered as much art as they were photographs. He began being discussed in the art press, not in just the as a magazine photographer, as an art photographer. And critics like Rosalind Krauss began talking about Penn as one of the radical precursors of postmodernism. Why was he radical? Because at the time, to to be a commercial photographer and produce art that was a reference to the history, and to produce photographs that were a reference to the history of art, was a radical idea. It was a mashup of art and photography that Penn knew all about, because of people like Brodovich, because of his experience with the artists. But certainly, the larger art world was about to learn their lesson. So when we begin to look at images like this, which Rosalind Krauss specifically cited as one of Penn's more radical pictures, we see a kind of 18th century memento mori, but we also see images that have many references to Dutch 18th century painting as much as it does to an idea of photography as something more than simple description. Penn was not above using the idea of still life in all kinds of ways, whether it was a reference to 18th century still life or whether it was to the Italian still lifes of Morandi, something simple and spare, and in this case, to more conceptual kinds of art. But it also, and this may be why Rosalind Krauss loved him so much, referred to the kind of advertising photographs that he did for clients like Clinique. Substitute skin supplies for men for little steel blocks, and you have the idea writ large. As Penn got older, as wiser, and more powerful as an artist, he also became more powerful as a magazine photographer. In the 1990s, Vogue increasingly did articles that were called editorials, and Penn was the go-to photographer for editorial image, such as these. These would have been known on the pages of Vogue as stoppers. Stoppers were the kinds of images that made you stop turning the page and look a little bit longer, and perhaps your eye might drift over and you might read the first few paragraphs of the article that went with them. This was a stopper that had to do with the idea of bee-stung lips that were quite popular. It was a live bee, by the way. Penn put them in the refrigerator and cooled them down, and it slowed them down, and he brought them out and photographed them with the model's permission, presumably. This is the kind of thing, this is the way it would have looked in the magazine. There's a stopper for you. Chocolate fantasy, why eating chocolate might be better for you than you think. And this is a stopper too. And I'm gonna stop here and just let you think a little bit about how the later Penn, a man who had spent 70 years in the business, where he began from and his tree of influence, and how an image like this, so dependent on an idea of surrealism, so dependent on an idea of photography, so dependent on an ability to experiment and invent and use the medium of photography in so many different ways. I would suggest to you that if Penn were a bit less modest, he might put his name firmly on the top of that tree as one of the influences that he had on himself. He was a man who absorbed, was inspired, and I hope was inspiring to us as well. I don't know, do we have time for questions? Yeah. So I'd love to answer any questions that you might have. Thank you very much.
And we can take just a couple of questions. If anyone has one, I'll bring the microphone to you.
Oh, surely I didn't tell you everything you wanted to know. No questions? Gosh. Yay, a question. Okay. Two questions.
I was just curious, did Penn go to Vogue as a photographer or as assistant to Lieberman?
He went as a photographer. He did. Well, let's see. He was there so briefly before he went off to Europe to the field service. But when he came back, he was definitely on the photography team at that time.
I believe I saw another hand right over here. Yes, sir.
Yes, can you tell us a little bit about his family, both his parents and any siblings, and if he had any children?
excuse me. He was born in Philadelphia. He had one brother, who you might be familiar with his work. Arthur Penn is Irving Penn's younger brother. His parents split up when Penn was about 12 years old. His mother moved to New York with Arthur, and Penn stayed in Philadelphia with his father. His father was a clockmaker, a repair person. He was married briefly at a very young age. As I say, he went to art school, technical school in Philadelphia, and moved to New York when Brodovich hired him. He spent time with Arthur, by the way. If you read Arthur's autobiography, he talks how his older brother Irving would come to New York and they would spend many afternoons crawling through the museums, and Irving would drag him along to all the galleries and that sort of thing. Penn was married to Lisa Fossengraves Penn. They met in the late 1940s. They were married in late 1949. Tom Penn was their only child, was born in late 1950, and is now director of the Irving Penn Foundation and is trained as an interior designer and graphic artist. So art stayed in the family.
I believe we have time for one more question, if anyone has one.
No? Gosh. Well, those are a satisfied group.
Well, if not, thank you so much, Mary, for your lecture.